Come with us on a journey to a place where information is unlocked, knowledge is gained, and the exchange of experiences welcome. This is the Knowledge Exchange, presented by Lakeland Community College.
All right, well, thank you. That's a great introduction. I have to be more prepared at my next couple Knowledge Exchange introductions. That was fantastic. Thank you very much. Appreciate it. Okay, well, as you guys are here to see some of the features of Windows 10, she covered quite a few of them real quick. I'm going to show you them a little more in depth. I have been running Windows 10 on this Surface Pro 2 basically since it came out, and I have a couple machines at home that I've installed it on, so I've been playing with it quite a bit. I will say that as far as Microsoft products go, this is actually I do like it quite a bit. I think it's a major improvement since Windows 8. Actually, Windows 8.1 was I didn't mind Windows 8.1 as much, but I think Windows 10 is definitely headed in the right direction. I will say, as far as what I've seen with Windows 10 is, like, all of your core functions work properly. One of the things Microsoft is saying is this might be one of their last releases, and what they've been doing is just constantly updating the system. So if I find something every once in a while I'll find something that doesn't work and it's broke, and then like 3 days later all of a sudden it's working again. So I do see that they are fixing quite a bit of things, but all the core features that I'm going to show you here today, they should all be pretty much working as well as you would expect. First thing, I know Windows 8 got a lot of negative criticism because they got rid of the start menu, and all the criticism, you know, for getting rid of the start menu was kind of funny to me, because after I got used to not having the start menu, I didn't see a reason to have the start menu. And now that they've brought it back, everyone's like, oh, the start menu's back. But what most people do with the start menu, I tend to tag the programs to the bar at the bottom, so I'll have easy access to my programs. And I'll just really quick, I'll show you. See all the icons that I have along the bottom. So instead of going to the start menu to start up a program, for me it's just much easier once I'm in a program to right click on the program and then pick the pin, or in this particular case it's saying unpin, but when a program's running that you don't use very often here, like Camtasia, I'll have the option to pin it to the taskbar. So for me, having the start menu back is not as big of a deal, because I pin the programs that I use the most right on the taskbar. But it is pretty nice. I mean, you do get the, now it's got the little Windows fly out. And one of the things that they've done with the start bar is, in Windows 8, you really felt like you had two personalities. You had the tablet personality and the desktop personality. And you still have those two personalities in Windows 10, but they've tried to minimize it, make it feel more cohesive. So instead of when you click on the start menu now, it does still bring up your icons and your live tile screens that you have, but you still have the old, like in Windows 7, you still have your old apps list, and you can scroll down your apps list and find them. When you're in your apps list, you can easily right click on the app, and then you can either pin it to the taskbar or pin it to the start. So if you pin it to the start, that's when it's going to show up into this box over here. So that is one thing that they've done with the start menu that's a little bit different. When on the start menu, they've tried to make it helpful here by putting in some of your recently most used programs, and I think they're using that a little bit for some advertising, because I've never used Skype, but yet it's showing up in my most used, so I'm not really sure. I think that they have a little ad in there for that. They also added a newly installed section, which I wasn't able to capture here, but in this little black section here, when I install new programs, they show up in this section, and at that point it makes it very easy for me to see the new program and either pin it to the start menu or to my taskbar, or you could just, you know, click it and run it. And again, they brought in the your power options are still here the way that they were before. So in Windows 8, they used to be you have to slide out the charms bar and then find the power, and it was a lot. I do think that the getting the power there is better. And I'm going to point this out. It's not really in the. One other thing too with this start area here is you can I could do a single tile or a double tile, or I think I can get it three. Maybe I don't have enough room on this particular computer, but. One other thing you have here on the start menu, and I will just point it out, even though it's not on my slides, is you can right-click on it. And some of the things, the old features that people are used to, there used to be like a start run. So if you used to type in something in the run, or you can get to the command prompt or control panel or some of your device settings a lot quicker instead of having to go through the menus, like to get to the control panel and those kind of things. So to me, I use that a lot if I'm going into some more of the advanced features, but your average person might not use it that much, but I do like to point it out that there is an option for the right click. So at this point, I know I want to make it, it is a presentation, but if I don't know if anybody has any additional questions about the changes to the start menu at this point. No? Okay. So then the next thing I'm going to talk about is Cortana. I will call her a she. There was a Halo game where Cortana was in, and at that point, she is a she in the video game, but they said that this Cortana is not related to the Halo game, but I don't know. I think that they are trying to relate their games into there. But anyhow, Cortana is an option that you can either turn on or turn off. When you first go into Windows, you'll see here I have this little circle here. Windows will show it up as a search bar like this. If you right click on the bar, you can set the property so it's just a circle. I do that because I put too many programs along the bottom, and this particular unit, the screen's not big enough for all the things that we tend to use. But Cortana is a lot like Siri. She, you know, if you can talk to her and have her do searches, and she'll say things back. The other thing, though, is that they're trying to make Cortana more of a digital assistant. And so one of the interesting things that I like about it is I put in both my Lakeland calendar and I put in my personal calendar because, as a number of you heard, you know, my daughters are in a lot of sports and I'm going all over the place. So whenever I put a calendar entry, I put in the location in the calendar entry where it is that I'm going. And what's funny is if there's traffic between where I'm at and where I'm going, then my laptop will say, hey, you know, you're supposed to be there at 4:15, but there's traffic getting across town. So it's maybe it's 3:30 and it's saying you might want to leave now. So she's trying to be helpful. A lot of people have some issues with Cortana because, you know, she is scanning everything on your computer. In order to be a digital assistant, she has to know these things. So you have to kind of give her the rights to do these things. If you give them, then they are trying to make her more helpful to you. If you decide not to, then obviously she won't come up. And I do have a section on privacy, so we'll cover some of that. Also with Cortana, what's nice is she also is scanning all of the documents you have in your on your machine, and she's got lists of your programs. So she's not just, so if you're asking a question or you're typing something in, she's not just gonna come back and give you just an internet answer. She'll give you answers based upon the files that you have in your system or what programs you have. So I pointed out also, like on the start bar with Cortana, is a lot of times I don't know what the program is, or I don't really, it's actually almost faster for me instead of clicking all apps and then going through the list. Even for this presentation, we had just recently installed Camtasia. So I just started to type in, I'll just put in PowerPoint because I know it's going to come up. And of course, when I'm trying to display it, she's not working. Oh well. I do use it quite a bit. The feature is like if I'm looking for a program, I type it up, it shows in the list, and it comes up very quickly. They must have updated that yesterday. It broke it. Yeah.
Do you need an internet connection to use the speak feature with Cortana?
That's a good question. I don't know for a fact. I am hooked up through the Wi-Fi here, so it should work. I haven't. I don't have the mobile phone version, which is where I have an Android for that. The guy I was hanging out with yesterday, they had Windows 8.1, and 8.1 has Cortana, and he spoke into it. So I know she listens, but I'm not sure. I'm assuming that it might have to have the internet connection, but I'm not 100% positive. But I can go back and check on that. Okay, so as I mentioned on the taskbar, the circle there is Cortana. I did make her more of an icon instead of the long search. There is the task switcher is a little bit different. So if you use the Alt tab, you can see your tasks listed, and you can switch just like you had before. So that is back. There is a task switcher icon though now, which is this one. So if you hit this one, then you can see that you've got all of your different tasks. And one of the features I'll show a little bit later is you can have multiple desktops in case you're working on a couple of different projects and one has got everything open to that project, but maybe someone calls you, you need to work on something else for an hour, you open up a new desktop, you can work on that and then just go back to the other desktop. But I will go into how to do that in one of the slides. But also running applications, you can see when you're running specific applications that there is a line under it. So if it's running, you'll see a line. And if it's not running, then you don't see a line. If you have multiple windows open of the same thing, you'll see like a little dotted line. So let me open up another Edge browser, and I'll just go to the Lakeland web page. So here, when I hover over the, if I hover over the icon, I should be able to see it. But if it's all in one tab, so let me put it in a separate tab. Move to new window. Okay, so now that it's two windows, you can see here the line has changed. It's kind of dotted, it's kind of small to see, but when I hover over it, you'll see both windows are there, and then I can pick which window I want to go into. Also, I had my Lakeland open. I wanted to point out while I'm here that if you want the slides under the Departments tab, Administrative Technologies, the slides are under this presentations area, and then you can select the Windows 10 slide deck. So if you need, because there's a few links in there that I don't know if you might use them later, especially if you're still deciding. There is two other icons here. One of the things that they did do away with Windows 8 and Windows 8.1 is that charms bar, but they did add a notifications area here. And if you think about it, on a cell phone or tablet anymore, you with like Apple or with the Android, you know, you swipe down and you have your notifications like listed in there. So this is very similar to that, except for it's just, you know, a little icon here, and then whatever notifications you have and whatever apps you're running, if you're running personal apps like Facebook or Twitter, or if you're using Lakeland Mail, or if you have personal mail, all of those notifications will show up in that notification center. And then they have on some of the, I know on Android on the top there's things that you can turn off and on, like Wi-Fi or Bluetooth, or you can change the, on here I could change for turning on quiet hours so that way you don't get notifications, airplane mode. So a lot of the things that you've gotten used to on your cell phone and on your tablets have been incorporated here. Obviously, as you know, Microsoft's been trying to create one, not just a desktop, but a desktop that is very familiar to you on a tablet or on the phone. So So this blends very, I think it blends very nicely. I do like this feature. Snap Assist. This is something that's been, something that has been in Windows since Windows XP, I think. And basically the idea is if I want to get two windows side by side, then you highlight, you grab the window on the top and you slide it to the right, and then it makes that window half the screen. And then you have to go, and before Windows 10, you'd have to go to the other program, highlight the toolbar at the top, and then slide that one to the left. The main improvement here is that once I slide to the right and I get my one half, if I want the other half, it gives me the task list programs, and the other half I can just simply one click, and now it's side by side. I didn't have to go through that extra step. That's a minor savings, but for someone like me, I use that quite a bit because I'm copying and pasting a lot. It is a nice feature. I also will point out that Snap Assist does a corner snap, so you can snap into the corners. This screen's so small, so I'm not really going to do that. But normally, most of the time, I just use the side-by-side screen. So that's Snap Assist. So like I said, it's available in XP, but it's not quite as streamlined. I pointed out the Action Center. Action Center is also part of this notification bar. So other things that you'll see in the Action Center is if you have too many programs starting up in the background, it'll say, hey, you've got four programs in the background. Maybe you want to disable one. Or it'll tell you, updates have been applied. Please restart. I'll continue moving on. This is also not a normal end user thing, but the command prompt, with a couple of quick settings on the command prompt, you can set it up so that way you can copy and paste from it without having, in the old command prompt, you always have to say, okay, I'm gonna mark, and then say you're gonna copy, and then, whereas with the new command prompt, you can, if you're in the command prompt a lot, like some of my techs are, you can hit a couple of these flags I set here and then change it so that way you can copy and paste very easy, and you can also make it such that the size of the window resides. Okay, so next we're going to talk about Windows Explorer changes. So Windows Explorer has been also updated a little bit. Windows Explorer has gotten a couple of things that they refreshed in there, and I'm going to just open up Explorer right now, and I'll show you. Couple of the features that I really like. One is when I first open up Explorer, what's nice is they have the frequent folders, and then they have your recent files. So what's beautiful, I really like this, is that anything that I've been doing recently is single click right there. I don't have to go back through and try to find it. It's right there. And also with the File Explorer changes, even if you're like doing an attachment in email, when you first open that attachment screen, you'll see that whatever your recent files are showing and your recent folders are showing. So it even makes it easier to attach a document inside of your mail, because it's already right there. And typically when you're sending an email, you're sending an attachment, it's basically a document that you just recently worked on. So from my aspect, it's nice because it does save these two features, save quite a few steps when I'm either just going back to open up a file or when I'm going back to attach a file in an email. There is, on the left-hand side, they have what's called the quick access. And if you're ever in a folder, you can right-click on it, and you can pin it to the quick access. I forget how to do it. There's a
third one down.
Yeah. So I can take this folder, which I do use a lot, and I can pin it to quick access. So that way on my quick access list, now I can just click on that folder. I'm already in the H drive administrations, admin tech, admin computing. So when I go into Windows Explorer, if I if I'm using something a lot and I pin it to quick access, it might save me 20 more clicks to get to that every time, right? So quick access is a great feature. It will automatically suggest places for you to put into quick access, but if you know that this is something you want, you can pin it there and then you'll see the little push pin. And if you don't want it to normally show up all the time, you can take the push pin away and just, you know, simply click on the, or right click on it and unpin it from quick access. One other feature in here is, you know, this PC, you can now see some of your common, you know, your Windows provided folders. You could see your drives and the share drives. And then under there is your, you know, your standard share drives that you normally see. But so those are, in a nutshell, I really like the way they adjusted the File Explorer because I think that they made it easier for you to find things that you've recently been working on and not have to use as many clicks to get there. Okay, the new web browser, as you can see here, it still has the old E, like Internet Explorer, but it's actually now called Microsoft Edge. Windows 10 comes with both the Edge browser and Internet Explorer 11. And Internet Explorer 11 is included because all of your web browsers are going away with plugins. So things like Java plugins, Silverlight, Flash, all of the browsers now, Chrome, Firefox, are making it harder for you to use those programs going forward. And the reason for that is whenever you have plugins on your browser window, when you click on the browser window, first off, it's a security hole, and a lot of security issues have happened on computers because of them. And two, with all those plugins running, when you open the browser up, now it's trying to run real time and Flash and Adobe PDF, and you know, so you're running all these 10 plugins that you might not even be using when you're browsing some generalized websites. So that's one of the reasons why Internet Explorer over the years has gotten slower. And one of the things that they are doing with Edge is they're saying, we're not allowing plugins. Your website needs to be supported natively on HTML5. And that's what all of the browsers are doing. So the Edge browser, what I do like about it is that it is very fast. It loads up very quickly. And one of the things with the Edge browser is if I get to something that needs a plugin, there's a menu item to say open it up in Internet Explorer, and then you can still use Internet Explorer for those sites that need the plugins. But moving forward, using Internet Explorer will be less and less needed. So I will imagine that if they did make a Windows 11, you won't see Windows Explorer around anymore. But it is in there for compatibility. One of the other things that they've done with the Edge browser, which is kind of interesting, and I haven't really needed to use it yet, but they have a, so first off, the triple dots here is where you can open up something with Internet Explorer. You can zoom in, zoom out, you know, your typical kind of settings kind of thing. And then I think it's this icon here. So if you want, they've integrated the web browser into being able to make notes, so I can highlight some stuff if I wanted to highlight it. So you can easily take a website, annotate the website. You can save the website picture for later use. I'm going to exit it for now. I haven't really done anything with that much, but I could see if you're collaborating with somebody, or you know, somebody was looking at your screen, you could, even right now, like if I wanted to try to highlight some stuff, I could probably do that. I think there'll be some pretty good applications with that in the future, but I haven't had a chance to really use it yet. Okay, this is really small. And basically, I already kind of covered it. Under the task list here, if you want another desktop, you just click on the desktop, and now I got a third desktop. And then I can I can actually, from here, if I wanted this program running in this desktop, I can just drag it and drop it over there. But now if I go onto my second desktop, you'll see the programs, other than the program that I dropped over here, was the Explorer is the only one that's running right now. So it's very clean if you're working on multiple projects and you want to switch between desktops. If you're no longer using a desktop, you can again click on that task view icon, and then you can click X and get rid of those extra desktops. So all of those words are explaining to you how to do that, but it's pretty simple. I haven't really used it that much. I have multiple monitors, so I kind of throw the programs on different monitors, but if I was on a single monitor, I'd probably use it a lot more. And this slide's also showing you how to do it. The Windows 8 and before, Microsoft always released their patches on Tuesday. With Windows 10, I don't know, sometimes they're releasing them in the middle of the night, they're releasing them all the time. One of the nice things with Windows 10 is that there is a feature when the updates happen, it'll ask you when you want to restart your computer. It'll say restart needed, restart now, or schedule. So you'll see an icon that says schedule. So if you click on schedule, then you'll get a menuing item that shows you what time that you want to pick. There's also under the settings menu, under update and security, under Windows updates, if I set advanced options, here I set it to notify to schedule restart. And so that's what gives me that option of putting in whatever time I want. If there was an actual update here right now, it would also in that section would ask me what date and time I want to restart. So sometimes, people tend to leave their computer running during the week. Maybe you want it to restart on Saturday while you're not there, so those updates get plugged on in. So it's kind of a nice, it's a small feature, but it's a nice little addition. Tablet mode is available on desktops with touch screens or on any actual tablet. And tablet mode, again, is something that I don't use on here because it's not really needed. But basically all tablet mode is going to do is, and because I'm running a PowerPoint, basically all it's doing is redisplaying the start menu. All of the icons that I pinned to the start menu are now just listed. And because this is an actual touch screen, I can kind of go down and pick the icon that I want. But I don't really use this much as a tablet in that particular sense. So if you hated that Windows 8 when you went into that start menu screen, but somebody out there really loved it, they would probably pick that mode. Wi-Fi Sense, this is a new feature. It's a little controversial. Basically, if you're running Windows 10 and you're on your home network and you have your little passcode that you have on your network, when you enter in your Wi-Fi connection, there's an option to say share it. And if you share it out, then any one of you can pick either Outlook, Skype, or Facebook. And then basically if anybody that's in your Facebook comes to your house and they're on Windows 10 or Windows 8.1 mobile or Windows 10 mobile, then they can connect up to your Wi-Fi and not necessarily have to have you tell them what the password is. They just automatically connect. So this is called crowdsourcing. So there's a little bit of controversy here because Microsoft has implemented it and not really giving you, they're not really asking for your permission. They're just saying, here, we've implemented this and it's gonna happen. So if you have a friend who comes over with a Windows mobile phone or a Windows 10 machine and you put that in there and they know what your password is and they share it out, there's a potential that they can then be sharing it out to all of their friends who you don't necessarily know. So In some sense, people like this feature because, you know, if you're going to a different friend's house, now you don't have to ask for passwords and they can get on your network and use your internet. I don't know. Personally, I don't want people getting on my home network without me knowing. I figure if you're my friend, I will put the password in for you, and I can save that on your machine. Whenever you come over to my house, you'll be connected. But I don't need your friends coming over to my house or even around and being able to get on my network. So if you don't want this feature, the only option you have to disable it is to change your Wi-Fi to say opt out. So my home network used to say something like RP home. Now it says RP home underscore opt out. So then I had to go change all my Roku devices, my DVD players, all my kids' phones, all of our computers. I had to change the printer that's on the Wi-Fi. So it's kind of a pain, but so what I'm telling you, though, is at your house, if you don't want your network to be shared and your password to be stored up on Microsoft's website somewhere, then you should go home and change your ID, your Wi-Fi SID SSID to have the underscore opt-out on it. If you don't mind and you want to use that feature, don't change it. You know, go ahead when you connect up with a Windows 10 device and share it out. I'm not telling you which way you should go about it. I'm just letting you know that it's a feature that's out there.
Is that like bigger security risk if it shares?
Well, here's my thing. It's like if I have a friend that comes over and they share it out to their friends, I don't necessarily know who their friends are. And on my home network, I set it up so it discovers different devices and it shares certain things out. So that way, between our different computers and stuff, I can get to folders without having as much security on that. So from my aspect, I want to make sure that I know who's on my network at my house. You know, some people are not doing those advanced sharing things with some of their data. You know, that's why I said it's a kind of a controversial one from Microsoft. I think one of the things that I read said if you wanted to be opted in to Wi-Fi Sense, then you should have changed your SSID to say opt-in instead of those people who don't want to be in. You know, it's like they kind of defaulted to take your permission away and you have to go in and change it. But I'm not sure that there's, as far as I know, as far as like federal regulations, what they've done is completely legal. So it's up to you as an end user to make that decision on your own. From my aspect, you know, there's so many places where my password can get hacked already that now having another place where it could be hacked and then having people who I don't necessarily know being able to get into my network. Again, it's just my house, right? So what are they gonna do? They're gonna pull up and sit in my backyard. You know, I mean, you know, it's not like that big of, maybe not that big of a deal. You know, so it's just something you need to be aware of and make a change one way or another. Whether you're on Windows 10 or not, this is something, if somebody comes in on the Windows 10 or on a Windows mobile device and they're asking for your network password, you have to make sure that they don't click the share button. So that's the other way. And then if you do click the, I should also point out that if you give your friend the password, or if you put the password in and you don't click the share button, if somebody goes to put the share button in, they'd have to know your password in order to share it back out. So there are some safeguards in without changing it. Somebody has to physically click that they want to share on the screens.
Is there a way to completely turn off Wi-Fi Sense?
There is, the only way to turn off Wi-Fi Sense on your network is to change your SID ID to have the underscore opt out. That's it.
If you don't click the share feature, does it not turn that on?
If you don't click, when you connect up to your Wi-Fi, you have to click, there's a button that you, and I can't really show you because the, our Wi-Fi is using a different standard and the passwords aren't shareable because it's on the, you know, you have to log in with your individual ID and password. But most home networks and small business networks are on that other standard. So when you do connect up to the Wi-Fi, there's an right under it, there's a checkbox that says share. And if you click share, then it'll ask you, do you want to share with Outlook, Skype, or Facebook? So then you have to click those ones on. So there's a couple of steps for somebody, if they're doing that, that they have to go out in order to share it. So that's why some people might not change it, because it's like, well, if I give my password out, or if somebody's on my device, I'll just put the password in so they don't know it. And if once you put the password in, you connect up, if you go to share it, you have to know the password in order to share it.
Knowing that, they wouldn't be able to share my password.
Yeah, right. It's a Windows 10 feature. Sorry. Phone companion. This one intrigues me, although I have not started to really use it. I tried playing around with it a little bit yesterday. I think one of the things that'll make this a lot nicer is Microsoft's got that in the cloud. You got the OneDrive in the cloud, and Microsoft Office 365. So if you're saving a file on Microsoft Office 365, and you're working it with the phone companion, if you install like one of the Office docs, because they released Word and Excel and PowerPoint for Android, iPhone, and there are apps on the Microsoft platform. So if you're working on a document on your computer and you save it into OneDrive, then it'll sync those documents up on your phone. So when you go to use them on your phone, they'll just show up and be there. I noticed on the Cortana, their idea here is that you'll install a Cortana app on your iPad or iPhone or Android, and based upon your things that you put in on your desktop, it'll also scan your mobile device. So when you do your searching on either your mobile device or your desktop, it'll mirror up all of that information into one bigger search for you. Also, if you get those alerts that I was mentioning that the traffic's bad and you need to go there early, those would come up. So they're planning on mirroring some of that digital assistance, but they don't have, right now it still says coming soon. Kind of like Dropbox, you can share photos on your OneDrive. So there's things that you can, so they've gone after a lot of those things that people are kind of doing with their mobile devices already. You might be using Google Drive or Dropbox for these kind of features. So this phone companion allows you to set up your desktop, laptop, tablet to also have those things on your other devices, iPhones and Androids. I will say the Microsoft App Store is really revamped. It does feel a lot cleaner than it was when they originally released Windows 8. And then when they updated it to 8.1, they improved it. But I think with Windows 10, they've made a lot of leaps and bounds with the App Store. And that is this icon here. So the App Store has, a lot more games and features and productivity. They've added a whole bunch of new apps. They added Twitter and Vine, and they've been trying to get more into the social networking. I was kind of surprised that they haven't added Pandora. I use iHeartRadio, but I was talking to my friend who has the Windows 8.1 phone, and the Pandora app is available only on the mobile devices. It's not available if you have if you are able to run the desktop. Pandora wants you to run it in the web browser versus in the app, because they get more advertising dollars that way. So they've added Fitbit, NFL, Gas Buddies there. So most of your popular apps that you have on Apple and iPhone, Android, and that kind of stuff are there. I will say, as far as social networking goes, my kids would not go with a Windows phone because right now they still don't have Snapchat or Instagram. I'm assuming that they're going to be correct adding those eventually. They also, by default, Windows 10 comes with Mail, a new email client. That's this one here. So it's kind of like, here I can have my different accounts. I have my Gmail, my Yahoo, and that kind of stuff. You know, when you click into different mail, you got, you know, your standard features, reply, forward. It does do, you know, grouping. They just recently changed it where you can group messages or not group messages. So they've been continuing to update this program to where it's more full featured. They've also have a maps. So you can do, you know, mapping just like you do with Google Maps and that kind of thing. And I thought I had it here. Yeah, maps. And so you can get directions and it'll tell you where you're going. It does your location and all of that kind of stuff. So, I mean, you guys have seen probably this stuff on a bunch of different tablets and phones. It just works the way you expect it to work. They've added new music, so the media player is still there, but by default they're moving more towards this groove music. And I think with the groove music, it kind of integrates some of the new things that they've added to the App Store, because in the App Store they've recently added movies and music. So just like when you're in Google Play or an Amazon store, you know, they're trying to upsell you on some of the additional things that they have content for. Unlike Android, though, they don't. I noticed they didn't have books in there yet, but there are touch versions of Word, Excel, PowerPoint, and OneNote. I didn't install those on mine because I have the full Office versions. Although I could see if I was without a keyboard where those apps would be more convenient. I will tell you, if you are on an Android or an Apple, they've released all of those full versions for free for you. So if you're using like a viewer from before, that the Microsoft versions are very nice, and they do allow you to do edits. And you know, you're not going to sit there and create a full blown like spreadsheet, but if you needed to change a couple quick numbers, they are full featured. They've improved their Netflix, Facebook, iHeartRadio, Flixster apps, so some of the apps that were there are definitely better. And and they've got nearly 700,000 apps now. So it used to be on Windows 8 when they first released it was like trying to find an app was like, you know, there was nothing in the store. I will say iPhone has 1.5 million apps, and Android has 1.6 million apps. So they're catching up. They're about halfway there. And I think, you know, with this release and once they release the phones and stuff, they'll get there even quicker than they are now.
Phones were released yesterday.
The phones, yeah. I have the phones look really nice, by the way. And I got a quick slide on it. I will mention a little bit of a difference here. I'm in PowerPoint, and you can see your traditional, you know, minimize versus resize versus maximize and then close. And one of the old things with the Windows apps, with Windows 8.1, they only ran full screen. You could split the screen like half and half. And if you're in tablet mode or on a mobile device, you still have that half and half split screen. But if you have it on a desktop, they've added the same kind of menus here. They look slightly different, but they do work basically the same. You are able to then resize the windows to whatever size you want. So that's, to me, from Windows 8.1 to Windows 10, that's a nice feature because, you know, I don't always want something that's like full screen the entire time. And also in Windows 8.1, you know, we used to have that charms bar that came out on the side, 8 and 8.1. So if you wanted to play around with settings, you really didn't have a feature for that. But here I'll show you like in Gas Buddy. What they did is now that the charms bar is gone, they created the, I call them the hamburger menu, the three menu. And then under here you can hit settings, and then it pretends like the charms bar is coming out on the right. But even if it's, you know, not full screen, when you hit it, it still slides out to the right. So they did that backward compatibility for the old apps that still need that charms bar in your settings and then come out. And I'm sorry to show this slide because gas just went up everywhere, 30 cents, 40 cents. So if you didn't buy gas yesterday, anyway. Gas Buddy, when you have it installed, will send you an alert. Gas is going up. So you know to go and fill your tank. Also here, there is a contact support app. With Windows 10, you get one free support contact with Microsoft if you have any particular issues. And I'm afraid because it's not been... Oh, there it is. Okay. So if I hit contact support app, then I can go ahead because this is I'm on an enterprise license, so it doesn't give me the same options as a desktop. But on the desktop, you can either go and ask the community, you can you can schedule a call and that kind of thing. If you go above your one free one, then they'll ask you to pay for support after that. But it's kind of nice to at least get your one free one. And then when it comes to quite a few items, there's in the settings, you can find it. It's called, I'll just call feedback. So here's feedback settings, but I think if I type it in here, I can just type in feedback. If I typed it in right. So here's Windows feedback. So sometimes if I don't know where a program is, I normally just click on the start menu and start typing it in and hope for the best. And most of the time it's right. So the feedback channel is nice because it really lets you details almost every aspect of Windows 10. And if there's something that you're like, I wish this menu option was there, or I wish that menu option was there, then you can go in and either see if the feedback's there and upvote it, or you can create a new feedback. And so Microsoft's been taking all this feedback and trying to improve their apps. I've also noticed in this mail app down here, there's this happy smiley face. Because all the feedback they're going to get is very happy and smiley and sunshiny. So, but then you can click it, that feedback there, and it'll bring you right into the feedback for just that mail app. So then you can just click the add new feedback, or you can see what other issues some other people are having. It doesn't mean they're going to fix it. It's just a way to let them know that, if they did something good, you can tell them, but... and most recent, they did just recently update the mail, so there might be people who are having other issues. But so I think that's nice. I'm not sure of any other vendor out there that's asking for feedback on every product and every aspect of their tools. So I think that's a one up for Microsoft long term. I think the more they get the feedback and people put information into there, then the better off that they'll be. Now going back to the Cortana, but also Microsoft, in order to make a lot of these things work, Microsoft, you've already given, if you own an iPhone or an Android phone, every time you install an app and it gives you like 25,000 things that it's, telling you that you're giving up, and all of those end user agreements that you click past. So you've pretty much are giving Apple and Android your location and your contacts. They're scanning your photos, they're checking. I was kind of upset because I sent a text and then I was seeing the ad on Google for a text that I sent. I'm like, really, you guys read my text and now your ad? So it's already happening, right? It's already happened like 5 years ago. The privacy went out the window, right? Microsoft took everything that everybody else was doing and say, hey, we're gonna do that now. So 80% of what you see in the privacy settings, people are already giving to Android and Apple. Does that make it right? It doesn't make it right. But I will tell you, and I think that Microsoft has pushed the limit even farther with Windows 10. But I will tell you though that the one of the things that I see here though that I do think is great is that under the privacy icon, every one of the things that they say that they're taking from you as part of piece of information, you can go down and tell them you don't want them to take it. So right now I've been leaving my stuff on for them to take it because one, I want them to improve their products, and two, I want to see what they're able to do with the information to help me do things better, like the Cortana telling me I have to leave 10 minutes early because there's traffic, right? You know, what I like on this setting is this is not something like, if I set it on Windows, then the apps don't get access to it either. So it's kind of a nice, I like it. I think it's a nice feature that they've given me a lot of settings for handling my privacy. Whereas I believe in the other, in my Android, I don't really have all of these settings that I can hit. I have a few of them, but not all of them. So that's a good place to go. If you want to be more private, you can turn a lot of that stuff off. Okay, my time is running short. I only have two more slides, but obviously if you have older hardware, what Windows 10 needs to run is fairly low, 1 gigahertz or faster, and 1 gigabyte or 2 if you're wanting to run 64-bit, and you need 16 gigs hard drive, and an 800 by 600 card, and also you will be required to create a Microsoft account, and you have to have internet access. So unlike XP with Windows 10, and you've all done it already on your iPhones and your Androids, you've created an account with them, and sometimes you can use, with Microsoft, you can use your own personal email account, but once you've created that account, then you can use that account on their site for the iDrive, and you get like 20 gigs of free storage and that kind of stuff. So it's kind of nice to have the account. So I will say though that if you're running only a 1 gig processor with 1 gig RAM, 1 gigahertz processor with 1 gig RAM, I don't know how good it's going to run. I mean, you probably would like to have better, way better stats than this, but that's what they say officially you need. There is a link on here, so if you download it and you go, you're on Windows 8, it'll tell you whether or not all of your stuff will work. It is free if you're on Windows 7 or Windows 8.1 until the end of July of next year. So if you're going to go to Windows 10 and you want it for free, you've still got like 7 or 8 months to make that decision. I would say that they've worked out enough of the bugs that I would go ahead and do it. If you're on Windows 8 and you haven't upgraded to Windows 8.1, you need to go to the Windows Store to get the Windows 8.1 update. Update to Windows 8.1, put all of the Windows updates on after that. So if you're on Windows 8, you got to go to the store, upgrade to 8.1, and then put the Windows updates on, and then you should be able to get to Windows 10 no problem. On the machines that I upgraded, this one and two others, the upgrade went very well. I would have to say this is probably the smoothest upgrade that I've ever had from Microsoft. I won't say that the upgrade is short, because it does take a long time to download these massive files, but I will say that it only asks you a couple of questions, and once you've answered those questions, it does it all the rest of the way, so you can kind of walk away. And after it downloads the program and you run it, then it'll download updates the program, and then it'll ask you one more question, and then you can just let it go, and it goes. If you are still on Windows XP or on Windows Vista, you still have to purchase. It is for the Home Edition, it's $119. If you want the Pro, it's $199. You can start with the Home Edition and then update to the Pro Pack for an additional $99. Most likely, if you're running XP, you've got an older machine. So of course, with the new OS, Microsoft is releasing a new series of equipment. They bought Nokia a few years back, and the new Lumina, the 950 and the 950 XL, sort of like the other phones. There's the standard size and then the big size. The front and back cameras are very high end. They've got a real nice zoom feature in there. The Surface 4 is what I have up on the upper left. I'm running a Surface Pro 2. What's nice about this is the keyboard pops right off. It's just a tablet. I have a docking station, so I have the second monitor. And it's got the mouse and the speakers with it. And then this is sort of the new Surface Book. And the Surface Book is about as thin as a MacBook Air. They are definitely going after that market. As you can see, the screen pops off, or you can keep it closed. It also flips around and back, so it's got a lot of features. It's a touch screen, so there's a lot of features that the MacBook doesn't have. And then it does run all of the Windows stuff, and then it also comes with a pen. I think they changed the way the pen works. I think it's supposed to just kind of dangle on the side a lot easier. Like on the Surface Pro 3, you had a stylus that would pull in and out and that kind of thing. But so, like you said, the phones came out today. So, right? Yesterday?
I thought it was yesterday.
Yeah. I think they made the announcement yesterday. Okay. They might not be out. They might not actually be out yet, but. You know, I have a feeling that they're going to have a line for sure. I mean, right now they have a 4% market share. I don't know if Windows 10 is going to be enough for them to be able to be an even player with the other two. But I will tell you, I'm due for an upgrade in January, and I might make the jump. Right, the only two apps I don't use that aren't there are Instagram and Snapchat, and I don't use either one of those. All the rest of my apps, they're all there. So I'm thinking I could make the jump, but.
Would we ever get a newer version of Windows here at Lakeland?
Actually, the Windows and the PC desktop support falls under Bill Knapp, so I know one of the things that we're considering is on the employee side next year, moving email off of Lotus Notes and into Microsoft 365. So that way, all of these desktop features like the OneDrive and sharing of your Word between your Word here and your Word maybe on an Android phone or an iPad, all of that would be more cohesive. So we are looking for ways that we can help support learning technologies moving into this environment more integrated in the future. But I do not know what Bill and Kim's time frame is for it. I will tell you, I've been running mine here since it came, and I'm able to run I haven't had an issue running anything. I can run it all. All right, well, if there's no more questions.
So you haven't run into any compatibility issues with software?
Not with the software. With the Surface 2, I've had a couple of issues with when I'm going from, like, there's like 5,000 different modes that I can run it in. After I installed it, I read that the Surface Pro 2 wasn't getting its updates officially for a couple of months. But I've noticed that over the last couple of months, they've really fixed a lot of those issues. So I'm able to get in and out of the different modes pretty easy. But as far as software goes, I've been able to run everything. So yeah. Okay. Thank you. Appreciate it.